What's up, guys? Welcome to part 5 of my rewrite for Star Wars Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker. Or, as I'm calling it in this rewrite, The Dawn of the Paladins. This is it, guys. This is the end. We finally made it. This is the conclusion of my rewrite for the entire sequel trilogy. If you guys haven't seen my rewrites for Episodes 7 and 8, or have not seen parts 1, 2, 3, and 4 of The Dawn of the Paladins yet, then you should probably go check those out before watching this video, because I'm just going to be diving straight into the story this time around. Normally, I would preface this video with a recap of the previous episodes, but this video is part 5 of 5, and it would honestly just take way too long to recount the entire rewrite for The Rise of Skywalker. So, if you guys are a little fuzzy on the story and need a refresher, then go back and watch parts 1 through 4, so that you can be fully on board for this finale. As always, the links to those previous episodes are in the description below. Okay, here we go. Act 3. Overall, the space battle above Coruscant will generally go down the same way that the space battle of Exegol did in the original Rise of Skywalker. The biggest differences will be that there are Yuuzhan Vong warriors aboard the Star Destroyers alongside the pure stormtroopers. The size of the First Order blockade will be nowhere near as large as the Exegol Final Order fleet, and the Wookiee fleet will also be mixed in with Sam's ragtag navy of resistance ships. The Knife 9 emerges out of hyperspace, and with the natural skills of the Skywalker bloodline running through his veins, Kylo Ren stylishly navigates through the battlefield and flies through the planetary shield gate. The Knife 9 lands before the Senate building, and Kylo Ren storms into his office, where he sees Supreme Leader Hux sitting in his chair, in his office, addressing his generals within the Supreme Council. Everyone looks up in shock at Kylo, but Hux looks absolutely terrified. There's nothing he can do now. He can't talk his way out of this. He knows he's done for. So Hux pulls out his pistol and fires at Kylo, but the true Supreme Leader stops the blaster bolt in midair and force pushes it back into Hux's shoulder, knocking him onto his back. The Supreme Council back away as without a word, Kylo levitates menacingly towards his prey, towering over everyone else like a god. Hux tries to crawl away in fear, begging the others for help, but Kylo Ren cuts off his cowardly whimpering by electrocuting Hux with the Force. Out of all the terrible things Kylo could do to kill him, Kylo Ren wants to humiliate General Hux and make him suffer before he dies, so he continues to fry the traitor as he screams in agony. This brutality will go on for a few uncomfortable minutes until there's nothing left of Hux but a smoldering and burnt corpse on the office floor. The rivalry between Hux and Kylo Ren has finally reached its end. A few members of the Supreme Council will cover their noses to mask the stench, but Kylo will ignore them and start giving out orders on how to repel the invaders. Frightened out of their wits, the Supreme Council hurry away to complete their master's bidding. As the Paladins are carving a path for themselves through the chaos in the streets, they suddenly see a ship fly over them, and they recognize it as the Knife 9 as it makes its way towards the Jedi Temple. "It's Kylo! He's going to beat us to the temple! We have to stop him!" Our heroes turn the corner and run into a fully mobilized battalion of pure stormtroopers, 30 strong. They all raise their blasters at the Paladins, but Kira steps forward and shoves out both of her arms in a massive force shockwave that plows the entire regiment off of their feet. Maz and Lobby look at Kira with concern as she stands with her shoulders hunched, sweat coming down her face, and a savage look in her eyes. Something feral has awoken inside of her. Without a word, Kira grabs a nearby speeder and barely waits for Maz and Lobby to hop on before she peels out and roars towards the temple. Up above the planet of Coruscant, the battle is going horribly for the Resistance. Even with the added numbers of the Wookiees on their side, they're severely outmatched and outgunned. Despite the fact that they're the invaders, the Resistance fleet is quickly put on the defense, and Sam seems to be the only pilot skilled enough to stay alive. Forget trying to take out the planetary shield, it's all about surviving at this point. One by one, all of the members of Black Squadron, Sam's former team of X-Wing fighters, are shot down and killed by enemy TIE fighters. Everywhere Sam turns, more and more of his friends are being picked off. He tries his best to keep his people motivated, but it's not enough. Sam stares out the window of the cockpit, hopeless in the face of the mighty First Order blockade.
"I'm sorry, my friends. I thought we had a shot, but There's too many of them.
This is it. This is how the war ends. With the First Order in control of the galaxy, and with the Resistance wiped out from history. All of their efforts and sacrifices having been wasted for nothing. Sam closes his eyes and prepares to meet his end alongside the rest of his troops. When he suddenly hears a voice call out to him over intercom. It's Lando. Sam opens up his eyes and sees an entire fleet of mismatched ships burst out of hyperspace. There's freighters, cruisers, corvettes, yachts, starfighters, and warships all combined. It's the smugglers and pirates from Nau Hutta. It's Lando and Maz's army.
I thought you said you were out of the fight. Nobody takes a shot at the Nau Hutta and gets to walk away smelling like roses. They stirred the hornet's nest now. Let's show them what we got.
This reinforcement scene will play out the same way that it does in the original film, with Sam and Zori being reunited on the battlefield, and Babu Frick tagging along for the ride. The Falcon will land on the planetary shield gate alongside Zori's Mandalorian freighter, and together, Zori and Sam will lead the Freeholders and the temporary ragtag crew of the Millennium Falcon in overwhelming the First Order forces guarding the gate. The planetary shield around Coruscant is finally lowered, thus allowing the Resistance fleet to come in and secure the capital. As the Freeholders and Resistance fighters cheer over their victory, Sam will look over at Zori and try to seduce her into giving him a kiss, but she soundly rejects his advance. Sam is suddenly contacted by Kira on his communicator, and she updates him on the status of Kylo Ren and the Codex. Zori will stay behind with the strike team to hold the shield gate, while Sam quickly hops into a nearby X-Wing docked in the hangar and flies down to the capital city to help his sister. Back at the temple, Kylo Ren anxiously strides towards the secret chamber when he suddenly hears voices whisper to him. He frantically turns around and activates his lightsaber, immediately on the defensive. There's nobody there. He presses on with his mission. In the distance, we can see the wheel start to materialize and fade into view, observing Kylo Ren ominously. Kira, Maz, and Loey make it to the front entrance of the Jedi Temple and begin force jumping their way up the flights of stairs when the three remaining stormtroopers of Sarlacc Squad jump down from the ceiling of the main entrance, blocking the Paladin's way. The Sarlacc troopers draw their weapons, and Kira passes Luke's green lightsaber to Maz as she ignites her yellow staff, and Loey draws out Anakin's blue lightsaber. Like the Praetorian Guards from the original version of Episode 8, Sarlacc Squad will be armed with weapons that can deflect lightsabers, like an electro chain whip, a vibro laser spear, and a double-bladed sword that can separate into a pair of daggers. Not to mention, they'll be armed with extra Mandalorian-inspired equipment like jetpacks, flamethrower gauntlets, and energy shields. These elite troopers are armed to specifically fight Jedi. For the sake of time, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail on this battle, but just know that Sarlacc Squad is pretty badass, and they prove to be tough opponents as they land multiple hits on the Paladins and nearly kill them a couple of times. Realizing that the trooper she's fighting is much better than her at swordplay, Kira resorts to using the Force to win, and she uses Force Crush to break all the bones in the trooper's body. For a quick second, Kira's eyes momentarily flash yellow as the trooper's shattered body collapses with a sickening crunch. Maz orders Kira to go on without them, and without a second thought, Kira dashes off into the temple after Kylo. She finds her half-brother just as he inserts the Codex into the opening on the wall, filled with cave paintings. The wall shifts and groans as centuries worth of dust shake off the stones and creates a suffocating cloud of dust. The wall opens and reveals a second chamber, illuminated with an unexplained holy light. Inside, there are two thrones of carven stone, and etched on the ground in between the thrones is a large circle of runes and emblems. The exact same kind of circle seen in the portals that are used in the World Between Worlds, the mystical plane of existence from the show Star Wars Rebels that allowed Ezra Bridger to go back in time through the use of the Force. Immediately realizing what Kylo is trying to do, Kira summons the Codex to her, force pulling it from the hole in the wall. As soon as she touches it, she becomes infused with divine power. She's lifted off her feet as her eyes and mouth glow brightly. Kylo turns and looks at Kira triumphantly as she lands lightly on her feet, permanently transformed by the power of the Codex. Like deja vu, Kylo Ren smiles and extends his hand out towards his sister, literally offering her the hand of friendship. He explains to her that this is it. This is his endgame. He's finally become more powerful than Darth Vader, than Snoke, and even Darth Sidious. But he's going to be better than them, and he's going to use his newfound power to save the galaxy, not condemn it. He's going to correct all of the evil that's ever occurred in the world by activating the portal, entering the world between worlds, and traveling back in time to when the universe was created, so that he can ensure that evil will never exist in this new timeline that he will create. He wants Kira to join him in this mission. They're different from everyone else. They always have been. Their Force Dyad is proof of that. And now, they're the two most powerful people in the galaxy. They deserve this. They deserve to win. And to be happy. Together, on those two thrones, they can rule the universe side by side. Kira looks at her brother in silence, misguided joy spread across his face. She slowly puts the codex away and gives Kylo her answer by activating her saber staff. His face falls into a disappointed frown.
So be it.
The climax of Act 3 kicks off as Kira and Kylo Ren charge towards each other and meet in an epic clash, engaging in their final duel. Their last stand against one another. Brother against sister. Warlord against paladin. Light against dark. Good against evil. Again, for the sake of time, I don't want to go into too much detail on this fight, but it's basically going to be like the duel between Rey and Kylo amidst the ruins of the second Death Star in the original Rise of Skywalker. Except, it will be cranked up to 11, because now that they're both essentially demigods, Kira and Kylo will fight unlike any Jedi or Sith we've ever seen before. They'll incorporate flying into their duel as they soar back and forth across the chamber, combining parkour with their new force powers and healing themselves as soon as one of them lands a blow on the other. They'll also try to use force lightning and force drain against each other, but to no avail, since both of them have enhanced reflexes now and are able to cut each other off before one of them can complete the spell. They're evenly matched, it seems. I don't know if John Williams would be down for this, but I think it would have been perfect to incorporate remixes of Duel of the Fates, Battle of the Heroes, and A Jedi's Fury into this final climactic duel, as it is the culmination of the entire Skywalker saga, and we can reinforce that musically by having all of the past soundtracks resurface for this final fight. Outside the temple, Lowie and Maz are having a hell of a time fighting off the last two Sarlacc squad troopers. All four of them are suffering multiple wounds, barely able to keep themselves standing. Lowie is knocked out, and before his foe can finish the job, Maz force pulls the trooper into her lightsaber, impaling him through the stomach. But the last remaining trooper punches Maz to the ground. Weak and tired, Maz tries to crawl away, and as the trooper limps over and raises his spear to deliver the final blow, a blinding flash of red light suddenly blots out Maz's vision. Where the Sarlacc trooper had once been, now only scorch marks remain. Maz turns around and looks over her shoulder, where an X-Wing hovers down and lands on top of the steps of the Jedi Temple. Sam comes sprinting out and checks on both Maz and Lowie. Before she collapses with exhaustion, Maz croaks out that Kira is inside the temple with Kylo. Sam nods and draws out his dual pistols, charging into the temple after his sister. Throughout Coruscant, more and more Resistance and Nal Hutta ships begin flying over the city, routing the First Ordered forces. Between the Stormtrooper uprising, the absence of Kylo Ren, the deactivation of the planetary shield, and the reinforcements from Lando, the First Order army is done and spent. The Yusong Vong warriors look at their First Order comrades in disgust, revolted by their pitiful military prowess. The Yusong Vong High Priest, who was present during the duel with Supreme Overlord Cash, looks about at the rest of his warriors. They never wanted to fight for these infidels. Their allegiance never truly belonged to heretics and heathens who worship Kol technology. So far, they've been honor-bound to participate in this war, but their heart was never in it. They'll be damned if they're going to join the First Order in defeat and face extinction at the hands of their mortal enemies once again. The warriors begin grumbling to each other. The man whom they owe their oath to, Kylo Ren, has not been seen for days. General Hux claimed he was dead. Therefore, their oath has been fulfilled. The High Priest commands his soldiers to overwhelm the stormtroopers guarding the nearby shuttles. General Pride and the rest of the Supreme Council try to stop the mutiny, ordering the Yusong Vong to stand down and remember their place. The High Priest lifts General Pride into the air by his neck, and like a vampire, he rips out Pride's throat with his fangs. The rest of his barbarians follow suit. Within a matter of seconds, all of the present stormtroopers and members of the Supreme Council are slaughtered, except for the shuttle's pilots. At Swordpoint, the Yusong Vong force the pilots to fly them back to Exegol. They're done with this war. They want to go home. Terrified, The First Order pilots comply, and dozens of shuttles suddenly disappear into hyperspace, abandoning the First Order to their fate. We cut back to the inside of the temple. Kira starts to become irritated by the stalemate of their duel, and her eyes start to flicker yellow with the dark side the more she gets frustrated. With a ferocious yell, Kira manages to finally land a critical strike as she disarms Kylo by chopping his fingers off. Kylo Ren stumbles back, clutching his wounded hand as he breathes through the pain. He looks up at her, sweat pouring freely down his face. Kira breathes viciously through her grit teeth as she gazes down at her opponent, her eyes shining a bright and sinister yellow.
"Look at yourself. You thought you could prove to my uncle that you were a Jedi, but you've proven something else. You can't go back now, just like I can't. The dark side is in our nature. Embrace it."
Kira hoists Kylo up with the Force and begins to drain his life essence out of him, absorbing all of his strength and power into herself. Every second that passes by, Kylo Ren is closer to death. With a slight motion of his hand, Kylo Ren summons his lightsaber back into his hand, and he swings, making direct contact with Kira's face. With an inhuman cry of pain, Kira drops to her knees, holding onto her eyes. She pulls her hands back, revealing gruesome burns across her face, and looks around hopelessly. She's been blinded. Kira falls back, motionless. Kylo turns around, and with half of his hand missing, he presses it up against the portal and activates it. The hieroglyphics around the portal become animated and start to move, creating a well of energy. Beyond the circle, Kylo Ren can see his destination start to materialize, the world between worlds. Kylo is suddenly hit with two blaster bolts from behind. He quickly force heals himself and turns around to see Sam walking towards him, unloading a barrage of blaster fire from his pistols. Kylo Ren dodges and deflects all the shots with his sword, forcing Sam to fight smarter and not harder as he begins running in a circle around Kylo, firing at him with one hand and throwing grenades at him with the other to keep Kylo on his toes. Meanwhile, Kira lies motionless as if dead, but her hand starts to move. Kira whispers,
"Luke."
She drags her shattered body to where the hilt of her staff rests on the floor. She hears voices whispering words of encouragement to her. She hears Luke. She hears Obi-Wan, Anakin, Yoda, Mace Windu. The Jedi of the past are there with her. They all are. With all of her strength, Kira rises, standing tall, and her lightsaber flies into her hand. Kylo Ren and Sam can't see them, but a host of wills flank Kira from all sides. Despite his valiant effort, Sam is overpowered by Kylo Ren. The clever Sam Solo is all out of tricks. Kylo Ren fires electricity at his brother, but the lightning is suddenly blocked by Kira's lightsaber as she stands in between both of her brothers. As soon as the lightning rebounds back towards him, Kylo abandons the effort and switches to a force drain, extracting the living energy from the last two family members he has left. They cry out as their life force drains away. They both collapse, pale, weak, and thin. Kylo Ren suddenly hears the voice of his mother, "Ben." Kylo turns around to see a force ghost of Leia standing before him.
"Please, Ben, remember who you are. They're all the family you have left. Come back to us, Ben. Come home."
Kylo Ren's eyes fill with tears as he looks at his deceased mother, the only parent he felt ever truly loved him. Her transparent hand gently touches his chest. He goes in for a hug, but Leia fades away before his arms can wrap around her. Kylo stares at the empty air, heartbroken. He turns back to his two siblings, lying at death's door. He slowly takes both Kira and Sam's hands into his. The living force flows back into both of them, as Kylo is reduced to an empty shell. As the energy is transferred, Kylo Ren has flashbacks of all of the sins he's committed. He remembers betraying Luke. He remembers leading the Knights of Ren into storming Luke's academy and murdering the rest of the Padawans. He remembers striking down his own father, watching on as his mother was vaporized, and delivering the fatal blow that killed his uncle, the best mentor he ever had. Ben Solo looks into both Sam and Kira's faces as they wake up and look at him in surprise.
I was so wrong. It's too late for me. I'm sorry.
A single tear rolls down Ben's cheek as he turns away from his brother and sister. Too weak to stand up from his kneeling position, Ben reaches for the hilt of his lightsaber
and mournfully bows his head, closing his eyes. He activates his lightsaber and impales himself through the torso. Ben Solo collapses, and Sam and Kira surround their fallen brother, saddened by the fact that this was how it had to end. In a circle of embrace, all three of the Solo children hold on to each other for a long time, silent tears trailing down their faces. A team of resistance fighters walk in on the quiet display of love and grief, watching with respectful stillness as Sam lifts his brother's corpse into his arms and limps towards the crowd of allies, with Kira blindly holding onto Sam's arm for guidance. The camera slowly fades to black as we close on all three character arcs for Kira, Sam, and Kylo. Like it was mentioned back at the beginning of this rewrite, the main theme of this film is anger builds nothing, but it can destroy everything. All three of the Solo children, the last generation of Skywalkers, chose how they wanted their anger to influence their lives, and how it led them down the paths they chose. We now move on to the final part of Act 3, the resolution. A few weeks have passed since the liberation of Coruscant. The Senate and the leaders of the New Republic's military will show their gratitude to Sam for leading the liberation effort with a ceremony where they offer him a medal in front of crowds of relieved Coruscant citizens. But Sam will humbly deflect all of the praise that is given to him, and express that he doesn't deserve as much thanks. It's Renegade Battalion who should be getting praised and honored instead of him. The New Republic politicians are unfamiliar with Renegade Battalion, and when Sam relays the story of the defective stormtroopers to them, the senators seem reluctant to believe in it. They doubt that stormtroopers could ever willingly convert and change their ways, but Sam passionately advocates for Finn, Titan Squad, and the rest of the stormtroopers who were brave enough to defect from the First Order and lay down their lives to save Coruscant. They wanted a chance to redeem themselves, and they fulfilled their oaths. Sam urges for Renegade Battalion's legacy to be observed, so a memorial is raised for the war heroes, and the construction guilds of Coruscant erect statues of Finn, Janna, TK, and a handful of other renegades. The monument will be unveiled to the public by Sam, and it will resemble the real-life monuments of the heroic defenders of Leningrad and the Marines Corps War Memorial in Arlington, Virginia. After the presentation of the memorial, Sam invites the surviving defective stormtroopers to come up and stand with him. We see the former stormtroopers, both aliens and humans alike, outfitted in new attire. They've traded in their black and red suits of armor for a more noble and knightly look, completely abandoning the toxic image of the stormtrooper. Sam will announce the reformation of the stormtroopers into an altruistic organization of missionaries known as the Disciples of Finn. The leader of the Disciples, a human formerly known as RK-514, but has recently adopted the name Rafe, will come up to speak and share that he and his brothers and sisters in arms have been victims their entire lives, having been kidnapped and indoctrinated by the First Order as babies. Now, they want to follow in their role model Finn's example, and dedicate their lives to helping victims, instead of continuing to be victims. The Disciples of Finn will begin doing volunteer work, charity services, and provide aid in the rebuilding and restoration efforts of Coruscant and its citizens. The Disciples are met with applause as Sam nods in approval. We cut to the planet of Kashyyyk, where the Wookiees have returned to their homes to honor the brave souls who died during the war against the First Order. The faces of the deceased warriors are carved into the trunks of the giant war-sheared trees. Chewbacca's face is one of the many faces that are carved, and both Sam and Loey return to Kashyyyk to witness the memorial of their fallen comrade. Afterwards, the rest of the Wookiees collectively cheer and celebrate the victorious end of the war. We then cut to one of the abandoned Jedi temples Kira, Sam, Han, Chewbacca, and R2 visited during the Episode 7 rewrite when they were searching for Luke Skywalker. It doesn't really matter which temple they go to or which planet it is located on, but we notice that there will be a lot of activity going on at the abandoned site. There will be crews of construction droids laboring away to make the temple hospitable once more. Mounds of debris are being cleared out, collapsed chambers and corridors are being repaired, and new support systems are being installed. Maz's pirate flagship, the Stranger's Fortune, lands, and both Maz and Grandmaster Kira emerge from the ship. Maz is now dressed in the white and silver robes of the Grey Paladins, and Kira now has a grey bandana wrapped around her eyes. She's dressed in a new set of grey robes, and she now uses a new staff as a walking stick to help her move about. They've just returned from delivering the Codex back to the Wills. Maz reassures Kira that the Codex will remain safe with its keepers, as it has since the beginning of time. The Codex is secure and back where it belongs. Just to make sure, Maz erases the coordinates to the Tree of Creation from her ship so that nobody can ever find it again. Maz's crew of pirates will be carrying all of their captain's antiques and collectibles into the temple when she returns. Maz will choose to keep all of the Force-related artifacts and relics that she's recovered over the years, but the chests full of credits and the treasure she's acquired throughout her career, she chooses to relinquish to her crew. Maz will climb up on top of a pile of loot and heartily bid farewell to her crew, telling them that it has been a glorious honor and a privilege to sail with such black-hearted scoundrels, but that it is now time for her to settle down. There's enough gold for all of the pirates to retire if they wish. If not, then Maz will encourage her former shipmates to take up arms with Lando Calrissian, if it is adventure and fortune that they still seek. Some of the pirates will sob and blubber humorously as they accept the loot and say goodbye to their captain. Maz then walks out to the hangar in front of the temple, where she sees Grandmaster Kira standing alone quietly. Maz joins Kira's side as the Millennium Falcon comes into view and lands at the hangar before them. Sam emerges from the ship with C-3PO at his side, except Sam is now outfitted in a New Republic uniform and his hair is neatly combed in a side part. Sam will inform Kira that because of his actions in saving Coruscant, the Senate have offered Sam a position in the New Republic Navy as a captain, with his own ship and crew to command. Sam came by to tell Kira that he has accepted the job, and that he is releasing C-3PO into her service. Sam explains that when he first freed C-3PO from his servitude to House Organa, the protocol droid freaked out and became very quickly depressed, without R2, Leia, or anyone else by his side, and without a specific purpose in life. C-3PO saw no other reason to continue functioning, and requested to be permanently terminated. To prevent C-3PO from committing suicide, Sam bestowed Kira as his new master, and when she hears of this, Kira decides to grant C-3PO a station within the Grey Paladin Order. She assigns the protocol droid to be the Order's historian and lore master, a position previously held by Lor San Tekka, back when Luke Skywalker had his Jedi Academy. C-3PO gratefully bows to Kira and heads into the temple, eager to tackle this new and ambitious task. Sam and Kira will exchange a warm and emotional hug as they both prepare to start their new lives. Sam turns to board the Falcon, but before he disappears into the ship, he stops and looks over his shoulder at Kira.
See you around, sis.
Sam winks and flashes a smile as he closes the ramp and fires up the Falcon's engines. Kira smiles as the ship takes off, and a single tear slides down her cheek from beneath the blindfold. May the Force be with you always, brother. C-3PO immediately sets up shop within the temple and begins organizing a library and a museum out of all of the ancient texts and relics contributed by the collections of Luke and Maz from their days of traveling together. Once that has been arranged, C-3PO pulls out the external hard drive that has all of R2's memories saved on it, and he uploads the drive into a nearby computer. We see the data being uploaded to the library's mainframe, and the audience will get a chance to see clips and images from all 9 films of the Skywalker saga as each memory is uploaded. This visual recap will be a nostalgic and emotional farewell for the audience, as seeing the entire story of the Skywalker family from start to finish will really sell the idea that this film is the end. It truly is the end of an era. It may not be the end of Star Wars, but it definitely is the end of the Skywalker story. Once all of R2's memories are uploaded, C-3PO will take the files and compile them into a single historical text, and as he contemplates on what the title should be, a couple of Wills suddenly materialize and they flutter around C-3PO's head without him realizing their presence. He suddenly gets an idea, and he types into the computer, "The Star Wars, The Adventures of the Skywalkers, as recorded by R2-D2, edited and compiled by C-3PO, Human-Cyborg Relations." This title will be a reference to one of the rough drafts that George Lucas had for Episode 4, and that working title for that script was called Star Wars, The Adventures of Luke Starkiller, from the Journal of the Wills. So now everything comes full circle. Anyways, the final scene will take place within the main hall of the new Grey Paladin Temple. Grandmaster Kira will enter with Master Maz Kanata at her side, where a crowd of new recruits anxiously await them. Among these new recruits are Lobaka and Zori, dressed in the white and silver robes of the Grey Paladins, with Zori wearing her Mandalorian Beskar suit of armor over her robes and having spray-painted her armor white. As a nice little Easter egg, I thought it would be cool to have some of the new recruits be characters from the Star Wars Legends comics who were members of Luke Skywalker's new Jedi Order. So along with Maz, Lobaka, and Zori, we'd have cameos of Jedi Knights like Qarran Horn, Kip Duron, Kyle Katarn, Cleek Hall, Dorsk 81, and Karana T. The crowd of new recruits will part to let Masters Kira and Maz walk past them. As she passes by her new students, Grandmaster Kira will recite the mantra to the Grey Paladin Code, which is a revised version of the Grey Jedi Code. There is no peace without sacrifice. Through passion, I gain focus. Through knowledge, I gain power. Through serenity, I gain strength. Through victory, I gain harmony. There is only the Force. Once they reach the end of the hall, Kira and Maz will walk up a dais where a damaged altar stands. Kira continues to address her new followers and tells them that the Jedi of old had lost their way when they became involved in galactic politics. The Grey Paladins will not make the same mistake. They will take up the mantle of the Jedi and continue to be the guardians of peace and justice in the galaxy. But their allegiance will be to no man or woman. It will be to the Force, now and forever. This is where they will be better than the Jedi. It is through these teachings that Kira will help the Grey Paladins stay on their righteous path. Despite her blindness, Kira will sense the presence of her master as the Force ghost of Luke appears in the background behind the altar, smiling at Kira from a distance. Kira turns around to face Luke, and even though she can't physically see him, she can feel him. She smiles back at Luke. Alongside him, we see the Force ghosts of Yoda, Obi-Wan, Anakin, Mace Windu, and the rest of the Jedi who perished in the previous films, as they all look on and smile at her. The iconic soundtrack called Finale will start to play, and the music swells up triumphantly as we cut to black. The final chapter within the Skywalker saga has been told. And that concludes not just our rewrite for Star Wars Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker, but it also concludes our rewrite for the entire sequel trilogy. For those of you who may be wondering, I do plan on one day rewriting Episodes 2 and 3 to complete my prequel trilogy rewrite and wrap up my entire Skywalker rewrite series, but as of right now, I don't know when that day will come. I have a lot of other videos that I would like to make, and just not enough time in the day to make all of them, unfortunately. School has been keeping me very, very busy lately, and I'm not even sure if I'll have time to dedicate to this channel at all once I graduate, so we'll just see what happens. As some of you may have noticed, I pulled some inspiration from Colin Trevorrow's Duel of the Fates, J.J. Abrams' Rise of Skywalker, as well as a few ideas of my own to create this Dawn of the Paladins rewrite in the hopes of making a satisfying conclusion to the Skywalker saga. It also took me a while to describe my version of the movie scene by scene, so keep that in mind when you guys say that this rewrite is unrealistically too long to be a movie, because in all honesty, if you were to try to describe any 2-hour movie scene by scene, it would take you just as much time to tell that story verbally as it would be to just watch the movie. So this rewrite roughly comes out to about the same runtime as a regular Star Wars film would. As always, if you guys like this video, please be sure to show your support by hitting that like button and sharing this video with your friends. If you want to know when the next video is released, go ahead and subscribe so that you can be the first to know whenever I post a new video. Leave a comment down below and let me know what you think of this entire sequel trilogy rewrite now that the whole story is complete. And I will catch you guys next time. May the Force be with you.